Hey everyone, welcome back to another PC port review. Today, we're looking at No More Heroes 3. Now, when I did the port review for No More Heroes 1 and 2, things did not go well for that game. In fact, it had to have some pretty heavy patching up until recently for it to actually be somewhat playable on PC. Hopefully, No More Heroes 3 builds off of that. We don't have that same issue here. But the developer is Grasshopper Manufacturer. The publisher is XSEED Games, Marvelous USA, and the description reads, Travis Touchdown is back, baby. The otaku assassin takes up his trusty beam katana once more to slash his way to the top of the Galactic Superhero Rankings and save the world in the latest entry in the No More Heroes series. On Steam, the game is normally $49.99. It is 10% off at the time of this recording for $44.99. There is single player, Steam achievements, Steam trading cards, partial controller support, and Steam cloud saves. The great thing is there is no DRM on this game either. The thing though, and the big sort of like area that I'm stuck with, is this game has a lot of aesthetic changes to it. And it has these aesthetic changes when you actually first boot the game. Now as you can see, the main menu and what you have here, if you're looking at it from like a UI perspective, it is disgusting. It's probably one of the worst things you could honestly see. But then again, that does fall into the No More Heroes sort of category of style. And then the options menu is just a straight up almost VCR options menu. You have things like camera settings. So camera sensitivity, vertical setting, horizontal, things like that. Now there is no mouse cursor here, although you do use the mouse to select and deselect. So left mouse click to select the option, right mouse click to go back. So even though this game has that aesthetic, and even though it's there, from a UI perspective and from a PC gaming perspective, it doesn't really help. And that's sort of the middle part where I'm stuck in. Do you go all the way in and go with the meme in this kind of series of games and force the user into that? Or do you break the barrier a little bit and provide like a simple 8-bit mouse cursor or a Windows 3.1 cursor to sort of like add to that sort of style to it? I think that would have been really nice to see. But this is sort of like what we're seeing here. So subtitles, minimap rotation, blood, that is normal or mild. There's nothing more than that. Language and voice language. For sound settings, we've got background music, sound effects, and voice. And then for graphics settings, here's what I honestly recommend. Before you launch the game, there is an actual launcher for the game directly. And so don't misconstrue my words when I say that. There is sort of like where you can preset all the settings before you launch the game. If not, the game will launch in 720p right off the bat. And you can make those adjustments before you start the game. And then when you start the game, you're going to be put into like an 8-bit sort of like retro style game. That's part of the whole, I would say, charm of this. So just be aware, nothing's going wrong when you first boot it up. It's just going to be like that. Now you have the brightness setting for display mode, and the game just crashed on me. So we are rebooted back after that crash, and that's why my suggestion is, in fact, to use that graphics settings launcher before you launch the game to get the settings that you want. That's not the best way to go about this, and the fact that they're using UE4 and this game is still operating in that light and having those major bugs, even in just the options menu, is scary in the first place. So I'm not going to make any changes here. My understanding is there is no widescreen support. I'm sorry, no ultra widescreen support, but we do have rebindable keys for keyboard and mouse, as well as for controller, which is really nice. Now, that is just to say, this game has some things going on with it, and it also has some things that are not great. So I'll show you what I mean in the main menu. But as we see here, just in the load screen game, we have 54% GPU usage, 30% on core 1, around 38, 39, and then around 19 to 20 all the way down the rest of the cores, 8 gigs of RAM being used, and we are sitting at 140 FPS. The nice thing, though, is that they do give you keyboard prompts. The only thing, though, is that when you are saving your game, it says, do not turn off your console when saving your game. On top of that, since this is Unreal Engine 4, you're going to have that shader caching stutter. And that's just going to be something that you have to deal with because it is UE4. So let's go ahead and jump into this next zone. And I'll show you guys how this game actually plays. Now, the thing that I really like here is that although they have done little nice touches like this, where they've added the prompts for keyboard and mouse, unlike the first two games before that were released, you can now actually use the mouse for those specific kills, which is nice because it just flows better and it's easier to pull off and just do. So let's go ahead and I'll show you guys some combat, and we are pretty much sitting quite well, so it's not too shabby, honestly. Some of the font is difficult to read though, especially the way that they've styled this, just to give you guys a heads up on that. There we go. Let's see if I can do this. There we go, look at that. The perfect dodge. So there's a lock-on ability as well, which is nice. Got a perfect dodge there. Oh, we have to go ahead and... crank up my sword. There we go. Did I not? Oh, I must have not pressed the right button. I'm just doing horrible on this. That's all right. Can we get a stun here? There we go. You had to do W and move the mouse up at the same time for that to happen, which is interesting. That was a very strange combination of keys to press, Alt and 3. Yeah, so the game, although it does run well, we are getting a steady 140 FPS. A lot of the control schemes you may have to adjust on your own, and I think that's going to be something you have to do, you know, as a case-by-case basis. Some of these keybinds and some of these controller inputs are a little bit strange, and honestly, my personal recommendation would be to use a controller because of what's that. Like, using the Alt key with S, like, that's so... such a weird combination. As a natural sort of like key press, I wouldn't recommend that at all. Let's see here. But yeah, I think a controller may be the better way of operating with this game. And you have full armor. Boom. Poison berry. It's not a bad running game, although it does run quite well. We are very quite stable. I just feel like there are still a few more hiccups and just the incessant crashing that happens for no reason. It seems to be a little bit awkward and strange, but what we'll do now is we will go ahead and show you guys how it actually runs on the Steam Deck. So you guys have that option there. And we'll take a look at that. So real quick before we jump into the Steam Deck version of the game, here's the options menu, and this is how you actually get out of the game. You don't press escape, you have to press T to get into the main menu, and then use the keys of 3 and 1 to sort of like move yourself across the actual menus. It's very strange how they sort of like did this. I'm sorry, 1 and 2 is how you do it. And then you have that slider on the bottom, and then you would use the WASD keys inside of the actual menu itself. It just feels very strange and doesn't seem intuitive for a PC game specifically. It seems more in tune for a console game. And I think that's sort of like where I have an issue with this game directly, because it has an aesthetic, it has a style, but for some reason during that style and aesthetic, it hinders and impacts the player negatively on this platform. Because you'll see when we get it on the Steam Deck next, you're going to see it's much easier to control and move through. So I highly recommend a controller for this specifically. So let's jump to the Steam Deck version now, and I'll show you guys there. All right, everyone, we are now here with the Steam Deck version of No More Heroes 3. We are playing everything at medium settings at 1280 by 800. So you can see we're using 42 to 46% GPU usage and around 24 to 40% usage on the CPU cores. It is running in DXVK, it's not using Vulkan. 800 by 600, that's not right. Let's do 1280 by 800, come on. Can this not do 1280 by 800? I guess it only does 800 by 600. Now, just for reference, this is definitely not verified for the Steam Deck. That's pretty much probably why this is happening. That's very strange. 800 by 500. Let's see if we can get something else here. It won't even go 12. That's such a strange resolution to deal with. 720 by 400. Look at that. That's kind of wild. We'll roll with that and see what happens then. That's probably most likely because of the Elgato capture card. I was playing it at 1280 by 800 on the actual deck screen alone. So that could have been just a bug from Elgato directly. Just the way it's converting it to the actual screen. So what we're seeing here is still some loading stutter, some shader cache stutter. And don't, of course, like every port review we have with this, it's going to look worse on the larger screen because of the fact that it's being blown up and then run through a capture. But let's go ahead and jump to the sushi shop. The cool thing this game is, it does have an aesthetic, and I am using, I have to force Proton 7.0-4 for it to be effective and actually load. So just be aware of that. Oh, and also, just to make you concerned about this, you will have some strange things happen, especially with FMVs in certain scenes, just because of the way the game actually runs. In the very beginning, there may be a black box on the bottom left where someone is talking, where they're supposed to be. As I said before, this is definitely not a confirmed version for Steam on the Steam Deck. So this is definitely just something that we're just running together that is not verified. Let's go ahead and just jump here. Yeah, it definitely is a little bit easier to do this on the controller, as you can see. But we're running 60 FPS, of course, at a very strange resolution. That's more than likely why. Once it turns pink. There we go, baby. There we go. Got some dodges in there. Look at that. Left bumper and A to activate it. There you go. Dominant enemy or pull off successful killer slash and the sleeve roll will spin. Look at that. Easy. There we go. Oh, that's cool. Yeah, this game has an aesthetic style that's really well done. And there's like a slight shader cache stutter, as you can see. But I gotta say, even though it's not verified, it is running quite well. So definitely take use of that. That's pretty much it. It's not a bad port, but not great. I give it a C-. There could be some things that would make it much better. I'm definitely stuck in the middle between the aesthetic of what it's trying to do and the ease of use for the GUI, but that's of course up to you. A controller is highly recommended for this game specifically, although it is playable on keyboard and mouse, but you will have to do some adjustments in the launcher before you start the game. Please do that. But that's it, everybody. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you want to subscribe to the channel and see more content like this, more gaming news, more PC port reports, more emulator videos, more fanboy content, subscribe. It means a lot. If you want to join the Discord, you can do that by becoming a YouTube member, a Patreon supporter, or a Twitch subscriber. Once again, thank you guys so much for watching. Hope you have a great one, and I'll see you next time.